It's been worse. It has. But we haven't been faced with this many different realities before. This is what's short-circuiting us. What's going to gradually happen is people are going to lose interest in those old power structures. The great shift of the ages is a grand solar flash. And all of the solar flares that we're having are like mini practice rounds for this one penultimate grand solar flash. And what is hell? Hell is a sense of being separate from God. That's what hell is.
I'd like to welcome to the show, Kerry K. How you doing, Kerry?
Hey, Alex. Great to be here. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for coming on the show. I'm looking forward to going down the rabbit hole with you on your interesting journey
through
life.
So you've had
an interesting life, to say the least. And but before you were able to, before your psychic abilities kind of came into play, did you have a life prior to these psychic abilities coming forward, or was it always there?
It was always there because illness was always there. So I feel like the two really went hand in hand, and I can't even separate them. So as far back as I can remember, I was very ill, and part and parcel of being that ill was spending a lot of time where people would describe as the other side of the veil. So it's always been there. I only know that as my normal. That's my, people talk about waking up. It's like a standard question I get asked on podcasts. So tell me about your awakening. When did you wake up? No. I didn't. It's just, this was always there.
So let me ask you, that was one thing I really wanted to dive into. So essentially you were a very ill child. So you were basically kind of dancing, you were almost having a near-death experience constantly all the time, meaning that you were living almost on the other side of the veil while still your body was recovering here. So as a child, you were exploring beyond the veil. I have to ask you first, how did you know? Because as a child, I've spoken to a lot of people who've had near-death experiences as a child. And that is treated very differently than an adult going on to the other side, generally speaking. Because if you go in there and all of a sudden you're 3 years old and you have the world's knowledge or the universe's knowledge inside of you, then you're like, well, it's a little bit different. So how did you deal with, did you understand you were on the other side? How did if there were beings on the other side, how did they react to you? Did they treat you childlike? Did you treat you like an adult? What was that like?
It was an ongoing experience. So my mom had this amazing calendar when I was little, and she would mark off the days when I was at home and the days when I was in hospital. And then at the end of each year, she would tally up the total of how many days I was in hospital and how many days I was at home, in the hopes that one day we would get to a year where I would have spent more time at home than in hospital, because my standard was hospital kind of was my primary home, and home was where I could go on vacation, you know, and I would get to go home every couple of weeks, sort of thing. So it, because it was an illness, was such an ongoing affair, what I was doing in that illness, I couldn't have described it to you if you paid me money. I didn't understand the depth and the enormity of what was going on. All that I knew was it was like having a dream. And then you wake up from the dream, which is when I would get better and go home. That was me waking up from this amazing dream I was having. And then I would get sick again and the dream would continue. So I'm sure you've had that experience where you go to sleep at night, you have a dream, you might wake up, go to the bathroom, come back, and your dream carries on. Except my whole childhood was that. My whole childhood was that ongoing dream with a couple of intermissions. And the dream kept getting more intense. And I kept learning more, I suppose, as I was getting older. I was learning more. I was firstly just exploring the other side of the veil. And then that exploration went deeper. It went beyond the initial introductions to perhaps a couple of angelic beings and some family members who were there almost as my guides. So that was perhaps the first couple of years I spent speaking to other beings, which I found fascinating. And then I went beyond them and I went beyond that. And I went to a place that, if you would have asked me as a child, where are you, Kerry? What are you seeing? I would have said, I'm just floating, which would have been an awful explanation. But it so surpassed anything that any human being that I know of could possibly experience. Where I landed up going was what I could best describe as pre-consciousness. So that's like the place where we come from before we incarnate into human bodies, the place where we are before we individuate into human form. So some people would refer to that as the ultimate monadic experience, meaning you are in the God mind, you're in the God heart, you're in the wholeness of creation before it becomes creation. And I was hanging out there. I was hanging out there for what landed up being a couple of years. And again, I would have just said to you, oh, I'm floating in peace. I'm floating in blissfulness. And it was such an otherworldly, unearthly experience that it literally took a galactic intervention to get me to see it, to get me to recognize what had happened, to get me to come to terms with where I'd been, what I'd seen, what I knew. Because to live in the conditioning of the false matrix and to have an experience of beyond the false matrix, and then to try to bring those two worlds together is not something I was equipped to do on my own. And once I'd recovered, which was more or less teenage years into early 20s, in that era, I worked with some amazing non-terrestrial beings who really helped me to actually come to terms with what I'd seen and where I'd been and what I knew.
So basically, you were in many ways Neo in the Matrix. I always like bringing the Matrix up, where you were in the inside the Matrix, but you were also inside the real world and the psychological, just the need to deal with it psychologically. How to c combine these two worlds? I mean, I've heard this before in many other iterations, meaning of near-death experiences, out-of-body experiences, spiritual awakenings. These kind of amazing experiences where you get a glimpse, you actually had much more of a glimpse on the other side while you're still here. So just trying to connect those two on just with our little brains, our little floppy disks. I always call it our little like 5-inch floppy disk from back in the day because it's so minuscule compared to the quantum, the computer that is the universe, if we use that as an analogy. So, okay. So when you were on the other side, so when you were going through all of this, I have to ask you, do you understand, or at least this is what I understand to be true. On the other side, we are before we are incarnated, we choose our life. We choose our blueprint, our soul plan, whatever word you like to use it, and we are put into certain paths, certain I call them mile markers that we're going to hit. How we get there is up to us. But these are things that we want to accomplish in this life. Is that your understanding as well?
Absolutely. Yeah.
So then understanding this and understanding that and having the knowledge that you have, why do you think your soul put you through so much at the beginning of your life? Because this is extreme amount of illness and uphill battles physically. And I know a lot of, I asked this question because I know a lot of people listening have had similar experiences of being very ill or very sick or are currently sick. I'd love you to just give a little bit of understanding of why this happened, not only to you, but why it happens to us as well.
To serve as a catalyst. That's the ultimate answer. Because would I be able to speak to you today as the Kerry K that I am now had I not had that experience? Honest to God, Alex, I wouldn't have dreamed of this. Even the Alex, if you met the teenager that I was so painfully shy. I wouldn't have been able to string a sentence together. I was pure petrified of everyone. I was petrified of the world. I was the least likely person. In fact, if you could have picked one person who would never do public speaking, who would never stand out in a crowd, I would be that girl. I would be her. I had nothing to contribute. I had nothing to say. And I believed that about myself. And all of that hardship for me is exactly what all of the hardship is for every single person listening. It's a springboard. It's a springboard to get you to reach a higher height that you would never get to otherwise. Like, we're so quick to dismiss discomfort. We're so quick to say that was bad and I suffered, and now the world maybe owes me something, or now I get to cop out because I've had this experience. No, because you've had pain and suffering, you actually get to stand up.
We are in a time of great change, and humanity is awakening more and more every day. Mankind needs insights on what is happening to all of us. That is why I'm inviting you to Wisdom from Beyond, a 6-day virtual summit designed to awaken your soul. Experience over 9 hours of soul-expanding channeling sessions led by 6 of the world's most esteemed channelers. Connect with the divine, receive sacred insights, and transform your journey by asking questions directly to the channelers themselves. This is more than just a summit. It is your gateway to understanding the profound shifts happening within and around all of us. Plus, when you sign up, you receive exclusive bonus content to deepen your spiritual exploration. Join us and step into the extraordinary.
You actually get to show up. You actually get your power activated because of the discomfort. Discomfort is one of the greatest blessings that we can have. A life of ease and a life of no challenge is a life of no growth. And that is simply not what we came here for. It's kind of like there's a place and a time for that ease and comfort, but it's not now. It's not now. And once we're on the other side, because that's one of the big things that I learned, was I learned about alchemy. I learned about what it is to transmute pain, to go through pain and suffering, and then not avoid pain and suffering, but learn how to alchemize it, learn how to transmute it. Would I be able to teach it? Would I know anything about it if I didn't go through the suffering? No, of course not. So if you ask me, was it a terrible thing? Even while I was going through all of that illness, it was never terrible. Alex, I got to sit in hospital and go to God. I mean, as far as pain and suffering goes, that's not it. That was a phenomenal blessing. Yes, my body was sore. Yes, I was scared of a whole lot of things. But to be fair, I was more scared of coming back into my body than leaving it. That was the easy part. That was the easy part. Every time I got better, I would feel myself kind of going, oh, damn it. Now I've got to fit this. And it really is a painful thing to take this totality that you've become and immersed yourself in. And now you've somehow got to fit it back into what seems to be this minuscule, tiny little ant of a body compared to the divinity of where you are. So that was the hard part. Coming back in body was the hard part. Being sick, wasn't that bad.
I've heard that before as well, that with near-death experiences, they're like the other side. I'd much rather stay there. Coming back here was like a heavy, dense
Very.
moving around, and I'm like, ugh, I gotta deal
Yeah.
with this again, kind
Yeah.
of vibe. So, was there any major lesson on the other side that you learned during those years that you'd like to share with the audience?
When I first started crossing over, I was filled with many, many questions. Questions like, what's the meaning of life? And the kind of questions people come to me with today, right? So this is something that I often smile at when I start working with people. I have an online community, so people might come into this online community and they come in with a list of a million questions. And it's like, what's the meaning of life? Why am I here? What's the meaning of suffering? What is karma a real thing? Why did I incarnate? I mean, just these forever lists of questions. So I was that person with this forever list of questions. And then over time, the questions got less and less and less. And it's not because I wasn't curious. It's not because I gave up on finding the answers. It's because I started connecting to the heart mind of God. And when you're there are no questions. There's nothing you would say, teach me. There's nothing you would say, ooh, I've got this important question I want an answer to. You only could immerse yourself in the allness that there is and experience yourself as the allness that already has every answer. that already has everything that you want to know neatly wrapped up inside of itself. And you just immerse yourself in there. So it's an interesting thing when you say, is there one thing that you learned? Well, there's a lot of things that I learned, but the most important was how to find my own answers instead of giving my power away and waiting for an angelic being to come and answer for me. What I was given was an opportunity to first get that, first get, some other being giving me the answers, but then to transcend that and move into that place of infinite awareness where there is no concept of a question or even of a linear thought. When you're in the heart mind of God, it's like you're in this infinite intelligence that speaks without words and knows everything all at once. And in that place, there is an ultimate contentment. So my journey that for me was the most interesting was learning how to integrate all of the time that I had spent there. Because as much as I'd been very chatty and had a lot of questions before I started merging with heart mind of God, it was there in the heart mind of pre-consciousness. The real core of my teachings came through. And they were, if I could sum it up, I would say to you, they were about alchemy. They were about what we as human beings are really here to do, which is to transcend the false matrix, transcend our pain, transcend our suffering, to be the change, to be the love, to be the answer, to be the fulfillment that we crave. So instead of asking questions, it's to become the answer to those questions. Those were the most meaningful things that I learned. And I learned them without even knowing that I was learning them. I learned them because I got to experience them.
Now, when you, as a child, like you were saying, when you were a teenager in your early 20s, you were fairly shy. So from that shy child to the lovely auditor that I'm hearing in front of me right now, there's a journey. When did you, when you were coming back, when did you start to have these abilities, these psychic abilities, start to really form themselves? Because I'm assuming that while you were a child and in your teenage years, you were going back and forth, but you weren't, these
Sure.
weren't fully formed yet. You had enough to
Correct.
deal with. They weren't going to toss a whole bunch of
Yeah.
psychic abilities on you.
Yeah.
So as when did these psychic abilities start to kind of form? When did you acknowledge them within yourself? And then when did you decide to make that leap out of that closet, the psychic closet, the spiritual closet?
Well, when I was younger, my mom was incredibly psychic. And they say that psychic people tend to be in families, And my mom's mom was also incredibly psychic, but there was a whole lot of taboo in the older generations. I mean, still in our generation, Alex, there was still a whole lot of taboo around being psychic. So as a kid, I learned to keep my mouth shut. Basically, I was the fly on the wall. I learned that when I said things, people thought that I was the weird one. So I just learned not to say things. But I always saw auras, for example. I always, like, I could see, for example, the person sitting in front of me, but I could also interact with their soul. I could also interact with the essence of them. And it was a big question mark for me. But why doesn't that person interact with their higher wisdom? Why is there a disconnect between the person I'm speaking to and their higher consciousness? It's as if they can't speak to their higher consciousness. Like I had no frame of reference for that because my mom was the closest person in my life. My mom was deeply connected. I was deeply connected. My world was very small, but the people in it were psychic or at least deeply connected to their spirituality. So it was a really difficult thing for me to make room in my understanding for how disconnected humanity was. And it was actually a place of great pain that I went into when I realized that the world that I was living in was populated by people who were disconnected from their true selves. And that's what made me want to do spiritual work. I wanted to show people a bridge that they could use to connect to themselves so that they didn't feel the loneliness, the desperate separation, isolation, loneliness that humanity feels is not because there aren't enough people in their life. It's because they're not in their life. They're not awake to who they are, connected to their depth. And It was my dream to be able to reveal the depth of each individual to themselves, for them to realize, oh my God, the thing that I was looking for all along was me. It was never someone outside of me. It was me. That was the gift I wanted to bring them. So I started probably in my early 20s doing a little bit of psychic work. And to be honest, I didn't really know what I was doing. I just knew that I was being called. I didn't have a plan. I didn't have a formula. I didn't have a way of working. I just sat with people and I shared their own wisdom with them. And when I did that, something in them resonated with what I was saying. Because, of course, it was their own wisdom that they were hearing reflected back at them. But then I noticed that there was one common problem in what I was doing, and that was that people kept coming back to me to give them the answers. And then I realized I had failed because that is not what I ever wanted. I never wanted to be an oracle for others. I never wanted people to go, oh, I need to ask Kerry. I wanted to show people there's the doorway to your own wisdom. There's the pathway to your own answers. Don't follow me, follow you. That's what I wanted. And when I realized I had failed my overall goal, I realized that I had to totally reconstruct the way that I was working. So I stopped working as a psychic and I started working as a spiritual teacher. And then it was not about, let me tell you who you are. It was then about, let me show you who you are. And that was maybe 10 years ago that I started doing that.
So at this point, do you still do readings or do you do anything like that? Nothing like that anymore. So when you
No.
say people come to you, are you just more of a counselor, a consultation? How does it work with you?
Yeah. So what I do is I only work in groups with people. The way I
Okay.
used to work was the very traditional way. So you would come to me one person at a time, one person at a time, psychic reading at a time. That's the way I used to work. The way I work now is only in groups because I realize that what I share with one person in a conversation or a psychic reading would benefit a thousand. So I learned, okay, I need to work in groups. And in these groups, I teach people. I teach people the art of alchemy. I teach people the divinity of who they actually are. I take people on energetic journeys, which some might call a meditation, where they get to experience the depth of themselves. I give them glimpses into the world that I went into the world that I came to know, where I merged with the heart mind of God. I take people there so that they learn, oh my God, I am God, that they learn to become the source of their own love and the source of their own wisdom so that they stop disempowering themselves. So the work that I do is to teach people, here's the false matrix, here's the programs of the false matrix, this is what it looks like. And then this is who you are outside of the false matrix. This is what you know. This is what you feel like outside of the false matrix. And then I give them the journey that I went on, which is now bring those two worlds together. And when you do, you are performing alchemy. You are bringing light of a higher world into the density of a darker world. And that's what we were born to do. We were born to alchemize the density of where we've been. And so much of what we've been taught, and this was one of the big reasons why I began to focus more on teaching, is because so much of what we were taught was to sidestep our pain, to avoid our discomfort. We were taught ultimately a spirituality that suited the false matrix. In the sense that our spiritual teachers, who were not bad, who were not wrong, who were perfect for where we were as a consciousness, they taught us only focus on the positive, only look at the good stuff, don't look at the bad stuff. And that doesn't serve humanity. That doesn't serve anyone, because then what happens is people think that they're failing when they feel depressed. They think that they're wrong when they feel discomfort. Or rage, or anger, or anything that is a real human emotion. They begin to think, well, I've got to be somehow this fairy godmother or this angelic perfection. And then I get to call myself a light worker. Then I get to call myself spiritual. So my work is to teach people, authenticity is your superpower. And if you're authentically in a place, be there fully, be there completely. Give yourself permission to be exactly where you are, as you are, so that you can discharge wherever you are, so that you can bring higher consciousness in to your world, into your reality, not because you're ignoring your pain, because you're transmuting your pain. That's a lesson that humanity didn't get. And that's a lesson that I bring in.
So I have to ask you, when you decided to start doing this work, was it an easy transition for your family, for your friends, for your, colleagues? I mean, because I always like to say this kind of work clears a room sometimes, especially the early work as a psychic, and you coming out with this pretty miraculous story of living in the other side of the veil while you've been sick for, many, many years. When this came out publicly, what was the reaction of people in your inner circle and close to you? And how did you deal with those reactions?
It was so easy because I was a recluse. I knew no one. I had no friends. So easy peasy, lemon squeezy. I had no issues. And then, best of all, I met my husband, and he was as weird, wild, wacky, and wonderful as I was. So there was never a conversation that had to go like, listen, I need to tell you that I'm kind of weird, because we both knew that we were the same kind of weird. And the kind of weird that we thought was normal, we looked at the rest of the world who couldn't talk. We looked at the rest of the world who couldn't see the Christ consciousness in each other, who couldn't see the divinity within them, and said, oh my God, they're weird, because we were kindred spirits. So thank you, God. The blessing that I've always had is that I have been surrounded, not I have chosen to surround myself by, but I have been surrounded by people on my wavelength my entire life. So the weirdness for me is when I encounter people who don't speak this language, it still makes me scratch my head. It still makes me go like, but aren't you acting? Aren't you actually just playing dumb? I mean, you really do know that you're an infinite being of cosmic intelligence, right? And then sometimes they go, no, I don't know that. And then I go, wow, strange.
Wow. I understand exactly what you mean. I completely understand what you mean. Now, the world seems to be a little bit upside down right now. It's a little bit, just a slight bit. And I always tell people, look, it's been much worse in the past. I don't care what anyone says. We're living in the best times ever. To be honest, really, in the scope of the last 2,000 years, this is a pretty good time, though crazy right now. And it seems like everything is kind of going upside down because of the access to media that we have and access to information from things happening around the world, where before we would live in our tribe and we wouldn't know if there was a war 30 miles away. And people could be dying by the masses, and we really wouldn't understand. So I wanted to ask you, what's your feeling on why humanity feels so upside down right now? Why there is so much division? Why there is so much ugliness being brought up to the surface for humanity right now?
Because we're at a convergence point right now. So we've lived in a timeline where, and this is really how timelines behave in general, and that is that the timeline that you're in tends to be populated by people of similar bandwidths to you, meaning people who are not the same, but at least in the same kind of reality field. That's where we used to live. So, like, for example, if you believed in war and you believed in injustice requires punishment, if those were your beliefs, you tended to live in a timeline where that was acceptable and where at least most people would be on your wavelength. But where we are right now is bringing all the timelines that ever existed into one big melting pot. And that's a lot of timelines. So, you've heard the expression, I'm sure, about passing through the eye of the needle. There's this wonderful biblical expression. I remember reading it as a kid, and just there was something about this eye of the needle thing that I don't know why it captivated me. And now I know why, because that's where we are. We're bringing all of the timelines into a convergence point, which means, first of all, this is why we have the Mandela effect. We have people from all of these timelines landing up in the same room, so to speak. And we've all watched different movies and heard different songs and have different endings to those movies and different words to those songs. Now we're in the same room trying to pretend that we were always part of the same reality, but we weren't. This is happening because we're preparing for ascension. This is happening because we're cleansing the false matrix. This is happening because there were so many timeline wars that splintered our reality into literally thousands of different timelines. Some of those timelines were abandoned, some of those timelines were populated, but it was a crazy mishmash of multiple timelines used to keep humanity essentially in a prison, a consciousness prison, where they couldn't reach beyond their band of consciousness. Now that we are in the process of purifying that, we find ourselves in such opposition because we're exposed to all of these different frequencies from the lowest low to the highest high. We're all in the same room with each other now. And what that does is it catalyzes, oh, but I like this. Oh, I don't like that. It brings up such contrast. And we're not used to seeing this much contrast. We're used to being in a timeline where we kind of could have disagreed with somebody, but we're at least in the same field of consciousness. We're not in the same. It's kind of like we have all the different realities that they could ever be occupying the same timeline right now. And that creates mishmash. That creates confusion. That creates contrast. And it's kind of like everybody's moving into this knee-jerk response to the opposite of what they like, the opposite of where they are. We haven't been exposed to it before. Now we are. And we must be because this is where we purify all the toxicity, all of the belief systems of the false matrix that don't serve us anymore. We're purifying all of that. So, of course, we must be exposed to all of that. We have the astral realm that has collapsed. We have so much going on inside this one timeline that people, to a large degree, are mentally not coping with what they're seeing. They're mentally not used to having this many different realities inside one space. It's temporary. It's not going to be this way forever. It's just where we are right now. And I've often explained it like this, that if we could go outside the timeline, because remember, that's where I'm used to being, right? If we could go outside the timeline and look at it almost like we were observers on the outside looking at the Earth timeline, what we would see is exactly what I've described, convergence points. We would see thousands of different tendrils all coming to one cohesive convergence point. And then at the convergence point, Alex, the timeline is going, wow. It's like, it looks like it's going to blow. And we would say to each other, oh my God, it looks like that thing's going to pop, because it is. Because that's the ascension point. Ascension then splits into one of two trajectories. And that's what we're in the process of doing. And everybody can feel the anticipation, like something's coming. And some people would say it's UFOs that are going to land, or other people would say it's a third world war that's going to break out. Other people would say it's disclosure that's going to happen. So people have got an idea that we're living in an extraordinary time, even though you're saying, and I do agree with you, that it's been worse. It has. But we haven't been faced with this many different realities before. This is what's short-circuiting us. And we're so used to being defined by the external world that when the external world has all these different possibilities, it's making us go, well, who the hell am I then? If the external world defines me, then I'm in a little bit of a mess because the external world right now is undefined. Again, that's perfection. It's exactly how it's supposed to be right now, because this is where we get to kind of flip the switch. And this is where we get to define ourselves and finally realize, oh my God, I was never meant to take my definition of self from the external world. Huh. I was meant to find a connection to who I am on the inside, to feel who I am on the inside, to grow who I am on the inside, and then let my inner world leak out, radiate out, ripple out, and become my external reality. So, in other words, I was meant to define reality instead of be defined by reality, because, of course, we were living in a false matrix. We were living in an upside down world that lived by upside down rules. So, we kind of know the abnormal and we call the abnormal normal. It's in the process of correcting itself right now. So, we're going to be faced with all possibilities, all options, all potentials, in order for us to purify that which is not our truth and then step into our truth.
The way you've put it is very interesting because I haven't heard that specific explanation of it, though it makes 110% sense. And even when I was growing up, you were right. There was disagreements. There's always been political strife, always since the beginning of politics, in the Roman days and earlier, and in Egyptian days, there's always been political strife. But even when I was growing up in the 70s and the 80s, there was division, but there could be cooperation, compromise. Now you can't even be seen eating at the same table at the high school, the high school lunchroom if you're in Congress, here in the States, because, oh my God, you're talking to the enemy. It has been so divided, so polarizing. And even I think it started around 2012, to be honest with you. And this is way before I. Anyway, this was never even in my eyes, twinkle in my eye, if you will. But I started to notice that I felt like I was, I'm like, I even said it out loud. I'm like, this, I feel like this is an alternate universe. Like, I feel like I literally feel like that this doesn't make any sense. What's going on around the world, the political changes that are happening, the religious changes in institutions, all these institutions start doing things. And I'm like, wait. This just doesn't, I feel so out of place. I feel like I'm in an alternate universe. And to many ways, I kind of still do feel like I'm in an alternate universe. I'm like, really? That guy? Really? That girl got into power? Like, it is mind blowing. It is mind blowing how people are, it's just the world that we're in. But I wanted to ask you, why is this happening now? Because we've had these timelines forever. What's the per what? What is this? Is it the Mayan calendar? No, I'm joking. No, but like I know this has been prophesized, and this time has been prophesized throughout the ancient texts, throughout the ancient world, that there was going to be this kind of time of reckoning. No one really understood what that meant, but I think we're starting to see it because we're in it. But why do you think this is happening at this moment in time?
Because we're in the great shift of the ages. Because there's only so long that darkness can do what it's been doing. There's only so long that that game can be played. And that game is in the process of unraveling. And what we're seeing is a desperate attempt by those who used to control the false matrix. We're seeing a desperate attempt for them to maintain their control of the false matrix. And the reason they're so desperate to try to get it back under their control is because the light workers or beings of light, whatever you want to call them, they began to transcend the mental prison that we were put in. They began to move into the world that I got to go to when I was so sick, which is the world beyond the false matrix, which means the divine matrix. There are beings on this planet who naturally, organically started to attain levels of love, levels of compassion, levels of peace that were beyond what the false matrix allowed for. And anytime we bring something into the false matrix that is not of the false matrix, alchemy begins to happen. And so we begin to dissolve the veil, which is the walls of the false matrix. We begin to dissolve that. So we're seeing almost what looks like two sides vying for dominance. We are seeing darkness vying for control. And the truth is, light will never vie for anything. Light will never want dominance. Light only wants unification. Because it's light, it's the nature of light, or the nature of God is to be in a state of wholeness, to be in a state of oneness. So, what we're actually seeing is not two sides vying for dominance, because I don't know if you've heard it before, but so many people say the light's gonna win or the light has won. The light is not in competition. The light doesn't care about winners and losers. Darkness does. Light certainly doesn't. Light only wants wholeness. So in essence, the light will become lighter, the dark will become darker. The light makes wholeness happen. The darkness wants separation to be maintained. Because if darkness lives in separation, instead of unity, instead of wholeness, then it remains separate and it gets a kind of a power for, or an illusion of power from darkness. That's, or from separation. That's really what darkness wants, is the illusion of separation to give them the illusion of power. Right now, that's all being reverted into wholeness, because ultimately it's time for that to happen. God has called this creation back. It was like this. It was like, okay, I'll let you have this experiment called the false matrix. I'll let you have this experience, but there'll come a time where I will call you all home again. And that's where we are right now. So we can call it by any name. We can call it the great shift of the ages, or ascension, or the harvest, or the event, or any number of names. It's all different names to describe the same thing. And that is an end to separation and a homecoming back to the wholeness that we all originate from. That's what this is.
Now, with the, this year has been such a political year. There's been global elections throughout the world. I'm not sure, was there an election in South Africa?
There was.
Yes, there was. There was. Yeah. So there's elections. I think it was over 50% of the countries in the world were having an election this year. So there's this year is definitely a pivotal point.
Yeah.
And where we're going. Now, living here in the States, the world kind of looks at us. You know, our elections definitely ripple around the world, unlike any other country on the planet. What is your take on what is happening, not only here in the States, but happening around the world with this political strife? Because it's not exclusively American. It is European. It's South African. It's everywhere around the world. So what's your feeling on what's happening here in the States? If you have a feeling on which direction it's going to, I'm not asking you who's going to win, but what direction the energies are going to go. And same goes with the rest of the elections around the world.
So there is a desperate attempt, as I said, for the beings of darkness, who we can call them again, many different names, but one overall name that I can give them is the archons, the archonic influencers, who are the ones who used to control the false matrix and hold humanity in this specific bandwidth that prevented us from connecting to our totality. They are doing everything in their power to bring humanity back into a smallness, a futility, a helplessness, a hopelessness, a continual fighting with each other. So all of the political shenanigans that we've seen going on have two sides. Just like our timeline right now has two main streams of consciousness. The one is being controlled by darkness, and the other one is being steered by light. So we're seeing that in every country that's having elections right now, that there is a higher outcome and there is a manipulated attempt to maintain control of the timeline, maintain control of the band of consciousness that humanity sits in and lives in. So if we look at the States, you're so correct in saying, it's like, you know, that saying about if the state sneezes, the whole world catches a cold. It's been like that because that's been the stronghold of darkness. That's been the seat that darkness used to operate from. And there were a couple of seats. Washington was one, the Vatican was another. And those seats of darkness have been compromised. Those seats have been exactly where the false matrix has crumbled the most, and where light has come in the most, which causes such polarization. And that's what we're seeing in countries like the US. We're seeing such polarization. And interestingly enough, you know, one of the things I always used to ask myself and any angelic being that I could come across was, why, oh, why would I be born in South Africa? Who got the wrong memo? Like whose mistake was this exactly? Because surely I'm in the wrong country, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And only now really do I see the wisdom of being born to Southern Africa. Because what I see in Southern Africa is This stands a very strong potential. Southern Africa, so not South, but the whole of Southern Africa, which includes Zambia, Zimbabwe, Mozambique, Botswana, Namibia, South Africa, of course. Africa stands the potential to be a place of 5D or a place of higher consciousness first. So where we used to have the US leading through darkness, leading through manipulation, leading through coercion, we could potentially see Southern Africa taking the place of global leader of consciousness, not political leader, but leader of consciousness. And there's interesting things taking place here in Southern Africa. There's really interesting shifts in consciousness. Just today, my husband and I snuck out for a wonderful breakfast. We had coffee together and we had this lovely waitress. And she was just telling us how sore her back was and how sore her feet were. And we were listening to her. And I said to her something along the lines of, "Isn't it beautiful when we can just be human with each other?" And her eyes got wide. And she said, "Yes, to be human first, not a race, color, not a religion, not a nationality. Isn't it just what we were all born to be, which is human first? And all the other separation labels, let them come last or let them fade into the background." And this waitress described to me exactly the change that we're seeing in Southern Africa at the moment. No, it's not everywhere. No, it's not in everyone. But there are a lot of people here who are just naturally shifting away from the government is in charge of me into I'm in charge of me. They're not begging for any government or any authority, give me my power back. They're just taking their power back. They're not waiting for any external authority to tell them, you have authority now. They're just starting to lead their lives and lead by example.
Now, Carrie, though, I see that also happening not only here, but in Europe and everywhere. It's a thing that is happening everywhere. The numbers of the show really tell that story. The reach of the show and what we're doing. And I see the countries who watch, and I see the languages who are, we're in multiple languages. So there is a massive shift happening, not only in Southern Africa, though I do believe it's happening there, but I see it around here in the United States without question, but also in Europe, also in the Middle East. Also, I see it from all around the world. So there is this great awakening that you're talking about. And I do agree that there is going to be new leadership in different areas of our life. Because as you mentioned, the Vatican, which is one of my favorite topics to talk about as a recovering Catholic. but the darkness of that institution, the harm that institution has done to the world throughout the centuries, the ability that it's held information back, it's held knowledge back, it's manipulated the teachings of Christ and teaching all this kind of stuff for its own power and gain. And I've said this on the show, but I was at the Vatican. I was standing there looking around and going, this has nothing to do with Jesus Christ. It was just such an awakening there. I'm like, it's nothing to do with a carpenter's son who walked around being kind to each other. It had nothing to do with any of that. So even on a just a basic logical standpoint, you can see the golden walls, literal golden wall, gold on walls, and people in pomp and circumstance with their robes and their things, and they're separating us from each other. And I think all of these dogmatic, fear-based religions around the world do that. Anything that separates us should not be really paid attention to. Would you agree?
100%, because that's the definition of darkness. Darkness craves, wants, upholds, reveres separation. Separation is where they get their power from. But where is light powerful? In unity, in wholeness. The waitress saying, "Hey, let's be human first, and then everything else comes after that." Yes, because that's wholeness. So anything to do with division and separation is what we've endured. It's what we've encountered. It's like You asked me at the beginning of the show, Alex. You said, oh, Kerry, what's it been like to be so sick? Blah, blah, blah. Must have been really difficult. But think of every human being in their own right. They've gone through their own hell. And what is hell? Hell is a sense of being separate from God. That's what hell is. And what is heaven? Heaven is a sense of being unified with God. We've come here to walk out of hell into heaven. We've come here to transcend the darkness into the light. And there are certain strongholds on the planet that were in the past tense holding darkness. The US was one of them. There are certain strongholds on the planet which are bound to hold more light and then to ripple that light into the rest of the world. Southern Africa happens to be one of them. But it's not because Southern Africa is special and amazing and everybody needs to come here. It's because this is the destiny of a continent that was indoctrinated into separation consciousness. Black people, white people, everything in the African story is about separation. So it kind of stands to reason that this would be the birthplace of unification, the birthplace of unity consciousness, the place that was so indoctrinated to be a stronghold of separation. So we're seeing massive shift in the world right now.
I've always said as like if I'm Latino from by birth, so I understand my culture very well in South America and the Caribbean and Central America. I always said if Central America or South America ever got together, the power that it would have globally would be massive. If Africa ever got together, it would dwarf anything the States or Europe or China or any of these other, it would be so powerful. But because they have been separated for so long, that is what that's allowing these other smaller entities to keep that control. I do think there is a change, though. There is something happening. Do you think that there is any event coming that, just like in 2000, 2020 when the pandemic happened, that was a major shock to the world that I've never seen in my lifetime, or to be frank, in any lifetime in history, that I could see that the entire world was affected by something. We had the communication abilities to let everybody know about it, and the whole world stopped for almost a month, like stopped. I never believed it. And it shocked everybody, and everybody had to sit there for, was forced to look inward just for a short amount of time, and it shook the world. And I think we're still definitely dealing with the ripples of that time. Do you think there's another event that's going to come in this next, I say before this decade is over, that's going to cause a shockwave that will force people to then look within themselves and also to look outward at these different entities of power? And we're picking on the US. There's a lot in Europe too. There's a lot all
Oh,
over
yeah.
China. There's a lot everywhere around the world. But not only countries, but institutions and industries, healthcare, pharmaceutical, food production, especially here in the States, economic, religious, all of these different media, all of these different entities that are going to really kind of knock the knees off from under them, because we're all just going to go, that's enough. We're not doing this anymore. Kind of like if there was a massive war again, I think everybody would just go, no. We're not doing this again. We've done this, that this is not acceptable. Is there something coming within these next 6 years or
Oh, yeah.
so?
Many things. Oh, boy.
It's not going to be just the one thing, is it? It's going to be another hit, another hit, another hit, another, because we're stubborn, apparently.
Exactly. It's going to be a whole lot of things. And pretty much from now, over the course of the next couple of years, we're going to have major, what we would think of as defining events, major cataclysmic events. And, we're gearing up for one right now, somewhere between now and November of 2024. We're gearing up towards some kind of interference on the timeline. And what that is when the light workers steer the timeline, which is exactly what we're doing right now, the controllers of the false matrix get kind of worried and they go, look, for example, we had this political stronghold in the US and it looks like that's failing. And it looks like we're going to get a president coming in who will not be part of the old structure. Maybe we'll usher in a different era. We don't want that to happen. They start getting panicky. They want then to introduce a fear event. And a fear event is very much like what we experienced in 2020. It takes everybody's focus and it harnesses everybody's focus into one place. And the moment that that happens, we lose our center, we lose our power. Because we have been in the false matrix directed by the media. The media has been our god. The media tells us, listen, there's a war and you must be outraged about it. Don't worry about what's going on in your own country. Worry about what we, the media, are telling you. Because we, the media, And so you get people then who go almost in a zombie-like fashion, you get people who go, yes, oh God, media. You tell me that this war in a foreign country, which I don't even have proof exists, it could just be CGI, but you're telling me that this is what I must be outraged about. So I'm going to be outraged. But the stuff that goes on in my own backyard, because nobody's telling me it matters, nobody's telling me it's important, I'm just going to ignore it. That's the world that we've lived in. And that's an example of the stronghold of political power that the US has held, because it's been a political as well as a media-led power that has originated in the US. What's going to gradually happen is people are going to lose interest in those old power structures.
It's
So
already happening.
actually,
Yeah, it's already happening.
exactly. So people, it's the conversation is going to steer away from, is Trump going to come in, into, am I going to realize how powerful I am? Am I going to realize that my life is not about an external leader? Am I going to realize that my life is about me leading myself? It's about me not listening to what the external authorities, which is the media, it's for me to stop listening there and start tuning in here. That shift is in the process of happening. But remember what I said, we've got desperation from the archonic influences that used to control the false matrix. We've got desperation from them. So in their desperation, they're going to introduce many attempted hijacking events upon the timeline to try to steer humanity's focus away from their own center, away from their own power, into the power of the false matrix, which is the power of the media, the power of outrage. So likely before November 2024, there'll be at least one, possibly more events to try to capture people's negative emotion, specifically the emotion of outrage. We will absolutely see, as we head towards 2027, we will see so many hints at what I call lights in the sky. So lights in the sky, this is to do with UFOs. This is to do with extraterrestrial contact. We're going to see between November of 2024 all the way into 2027, we're going to see hint after hint after hint that there are these lights in the sky. And then eventually those hints are going to become a full-blown acknowledgement. Okay, there is contact. And an interesting thing is we were told, and Alex, I don't even remember, was it before 2020? I think it was. We were told life on other planets is not just a possibility, it's an
It's a,
absolute probability.
of course.
And what did humanity do? Humanity went, meh, meh. What?
I got too many other things I'm worried about. Yeah, I got to look over here. I got to look over there. There's literally
Exactly.
government. Here in the States, there was hearings set up to tell you about UFOs and AUFs or AU, the other
Yeah, what
one.
is it? Yeah.
But you know what I'm talking about. And abnormal flying something or other. And but they were saying, like, military people were like, here's the video of it. We don't know what it is. And I remember, like, you know what kind of craziness was going around when that happened? That, hey, there's UFOs or there's these things that we don't know what they are in the sky. Here's the video proof. We're telling you we don't know what it is. This is coming straight from the government, not a whistleblower, people who are in the government. Saying, we don't know what it is. And no one even blinked.
Nobody
No one
blinked. No.
even was like, I go, meh. That's exactly what I was like. Did no one else just hear that? You know, it's like it's not the X-Files anymore. It's a little bit different. So you're not the first person on the show who's told me about contacts that's happening before the decade is over. And I do believe that if it does happen, it will be a catalyst for humanity, because at that point, I'm hoping that we join together to understand that there's something much bigger than we are. We get out of this kind of frequency that we're in. Harry, what is the biggest challenge we have in humanity's future, in the shift in consciousness, in all of it?
Victimhood. When somebody believes and perceives of themselves as a victim needs a rescuer. A victim basically doesn't have power. And that's exactly what feeds the false matrix. The false matrix is fed and fueled by misery, suffering, victimhood, and a irresponsibility with our own power. And that's what victimhood is. Victimhood is a disowning of power. So that's the great danger. Everybody thinks the danger is going to come from out there. The danger is going to come from AI. The danger is going to come from the sky. The real danger is the mindset of the individual that is so prone and so programmed to give their power away. And in the victimhood, what they do is they say, okay, I'm too weak, too wounded, and too small to be powerful. So you, media, you, government, you, somebody else. Somebody outside of me, you must be powerful for me. I don't know what to do. I'm not powerful, so you must be powerful for me. That's the danger that we face. And it's because of that mindset that humanity has been locked into a mental prison, which is a prison of frequency for so many eons. The liberator, the freedom ticket out of the false matrix is when we take personal responsibility for our own lives. And when we take personal responsibility, we become able to respond. That's what responsibility is. It's our ability to respond. And if I'm able to respond, then I don't have to ask somebody else to respond on my behalf. I don't have to appoint a government to represent me when I'm able to represent myself. When I'm powerful, then I don't need anybody else to be powerful on my behalf. So the ticket out of the false matrix and out of the victimhood is actually the ticket of personal responsibility, which leads to personal power, which leads to personal freedom. That's a roadmap right there of what it looks like for humanity to become independent of the false matrix and to shift into their higher reality, which is a world that is still planet Earth. But not the old planet Earth that we know. We're shifting into a literal new reality on planet Earth that will look as if it is a new Earth itself. And that's what there are so many attempts being made right now to prevent that from happening. Because when humanity shifts, the grand shift of the ages, when humanity shifts into their power, they begin to collapse the false matrix and to birth the truth of who they are in a world that now is part of the divine matrix, part of the divine organic universe that we came from. And when that happens, Earth is going to look a lot different. Earth is going to start to look like, well, some people call it New Earth, which I don't. I would call it True Earth. I would also call it Eden because that's the original Earth. That's what Earth was before it was taken over. We are restoring Eden here on this planet. We don't even have to go to a different planet. It is being restored here through each and every single one of us. But the only thing that can actually prevent that is victimhood.
Let me ask you, where do you think religion is going to play a part in this new earth, this Eden that we're coming into? Is it going to survive? What
No,
will
God,
so the
no.
pa so the
No pun
Vatican ha
intended.
so so the Vatican, for I'll use them because they are arguably the most powerful, one of the most powerful entities on the planet. They have a lot of wealth, they have a lot of power, they have a lot of control even behind the scenes of things. And that's not a conspiracy theory. That is
Sure.
just
Yeah,
the fact.
fact. Yeah.
Just go visit St. Peter's Basilica and you'll understand. So what happens to an institution like that, which it's been, by the way, being hit from a thousand different places with a lot of things that have been disclosed, a lot of cracks in the foundation that has happened. Where do you see something like the Vat? Where do you see the Vatican or religion, organized dogmatic religion, that has served us in the past, and it did have a purpose early on, but it doesn't
Correct.
serve us anymore. Where do you see this going in this new earth, this Eden that we're going to be creating?
There was a being that walked this planet. We know this being as Jesus the Christ.
Mm-hmm.
And this Christed being was so powerful because that is what a Christed being is. A Christed being is a being who's fully responsible for themselves. The being that I was describing earlier is a Christed being. The being who's fully responsible, fully powerful, fully immersed in love, fully aligned to the divine matrix, that is a Christed being. So, of course, when Christ said that he will return, what we interpreted that as, and actually not we, the humans, what the Vatican told us that meant was Jesus is going to come back. This one individual person is going to come back. No, Christ consciousness is going to be rebirthed on the planet through all of us who are alive right now. That's the return of Christ. It's the return of Christ consciousness. If we look at all the perversions in religion, I can 1000% agree with you. Yes, there was a time when religion was very, very needed, desperately needed on this planet, but then it became a tool of the dark ones. It became a tool of the creators. And I actually wrote it down because I didn't want to forget. You used the perfect word to describe the Vatican. You described it as a powerful entity. What's an entity? It's a demon. It's an attachment. So you are 100% correct when you described it as a powerful entity that perverted so many of the pure, pristine teachings that Jesus the Christ brought to this planet because he was assigned to bring love and legacy of love to this planet that would withstand the greatest malevolent manipulation known to man, which is religion, because Christ wasn't a Christian. Christ wasn't religious. Christ was an example of our potential, that we may all be Christed and return to our true nature, our true origins. So what would happen, therefore, to religion? You could also ask me, Kerry, what would happen to plastic and pollution? What would happen to anything of the false matrix? What would happen to anything that was used to coerce and manipulate humanity? The answer is that dissolves as we shift into ascension, which is known as the great shift of the ages. It is a great solar flash that comes from the sun that signifies the ultimate turn of events on this planet. The ultimate shift is that ascension point. And at that point, religion melts away. The false matrix melts away. Pollution melts away. Coercion, manipulation, entities, deviance, all of that melts away. And there is then no more room left for it because at that point, the timeline is finally purified into a 5D timeline, which is Eden. At that point, Eden is restored, rebirthed, and everything not of the organic divine matrix dissolves at the material level. Right now, we're dissolving at the personal, individual, inner level, everything connected to the false matrix. That's for each one of us to do. That's our Christed path, our Christ journey, is to dissolve all of the darkness within so that we prepare ourselves, humanity, and the timeline to host Christed consciousness post the ascension event, which is the 5D world that so many spiritual people talk about. But I feel, Alex, that they talk about it almost with too much woo-woo, almost like too fantastical, It's like, oh, there's going to be these big lights in the sky and you're all going to be angels. This is a very real, very practical, very physical experience that we are all being prepared for. And,
So, well, so that you were saying the solar flares. Can we dive into a little bit about that? Because people have been asking me about the solar flares, and of course, there's fear around it, and all this kind of stuff. But this is not woo-woo. This is science. This is these solar flares are hitting us. There are going to be disruptions in our everyday world because of what's happening. Our magnetic field is thinner or weaker than it usually is because of the time of we are
Correct.
in, I guess, the time in our cycle or something along those lines, where the magnetic field that usually protects us
Correct.
is thinning or weakening. So these flares will connect with us more. Can you dive in a little bit of what is the purpose, like the spiritual purpose of this? Why is this happening?
Well, now you're asking me about my favorite subject. So, yeah, this is what we were born for. This is what we came into embodiment for. If ever we scratch our heads and we go, what in God's name am I doing here? It is to be a ripple that prepares the planet for this great shift of the ages. The great shift of the ages is a grand solar flash. And all of the solar flares that we're having are like mini practice rounds for this one penultimate grand solar flash, which is also known as a micronova, not a macro, but a micronova, meaning the full coronal mass of the sun. Imagine this, the full coronal mass ejecting from the sun. Now, when I say that to people, exactly, Alex, when I say that to people and they've got a little bit of seichel and they understand, ooh, she's not talking about a little solar flare, because that's what we have right now. All these little solar flares, remember what they are? They are practice rounds to prepare us for the big one. The big one is a full coronal mass ejection. Many people, when they hear that, they go, nothing's going to survive. Nothing can survive, because that would be an extinction level event. It is not an extinction level event. It is a catalyst that comes from the sun. The sun is a portal. It is a gateway for Christ light. It is a gateway for God consciousness. It is a literal stargate. That's what our sun is. It's a stargate that allows God's love light back onto the planet. In the false matrix, we were separated from that stargate, which is our sun. The veil that we talk about, you know, people talk about on the other side of the veil literally has encapsulated the false matrix and kept it a gorgeous, pristine quarantine zone wherein all who populated the false matrix have been kept in a state of separation and disconnection. When that grand micronova comes, it melts the veil and it restores humanity, or at least offers humanity the possibility and potential to be restored at the body level. So it's the correction of the false matrix at the physical body level, because our bodies are designed to uphold the false matrix, be programmed by the false matrix. They're designed to navigate the false matrix. Our bodies are not designed at this stage right now to navigate the divine matrix. That grand solar flash is a melting away of everything that kept us entrapped and ensnared in darkness. It reveals who we are as light beings. So every time we have these little practice solar flashes, which we call a solar flare or a coronal mass ejection, every time we have one of these, people will say things like, oh, I don't know why, but I'm so much more sensitive suddenly. And we can all experience sensitivity differently. You know, some people it's emotionally sensitive. Some people it's physically, like rashes on the skin and breakouts where they didn't used to have it, or illness that suddenly comes out of nowhere. We all have different ways of melting away the old programs that we used to host in our literal bodies. So every time we have a solar flare, it's a melting away of the template that caused us to correlate to the false matrix. That gets melted away in preparation for the grand micronova, the grand solar flash, which is the ascension point. There will be those beings who don't survive. There will be those beings who say, look, this isn't for me. Thank you very much. I'm not at that point that I'm ready to move into 5D or move into higher gear. They leave the planet then and they move off into another new reality, another new identity, another life essentially, which they get to then prepare themselves for a whole new ascension cycle. For those of us here on planet Earth who are saying yes, yes to the madness of personal growth, yes to the craziness of facing my traumas and my discomfort, yes to self-discovery, to those mavericks and pioneers who are saying yes, they're saying yes to themselves being, in a sense, reborn as the higher version of self in the same body. It's kind of like a life within a life. It's kind of like having the opportunity to keep the same body and the same name, to be a light being not just at the physical level, but also at the level of consciousness. So that's what we're gearing up towards. That's what all of this fight is about that we're seeing on the planet. That's what all of our emotional preparation is about. It's preparing us to be the higher version of ourselves, which is also a death of the lower version of self. It's a goodbye to the small self, to the victim self. It's a letting go and a release of all of that.
Now, I'm going to ask you a few questions to ask all my guests, Kerry. What is your definition of living a fulfilled life?
To live a fulfilled life is to live as you, the fullness of you, the totality of you, the wholeness of you. That's fulfillment. The lack of fulfillment is when you are pretending to be somebody else. It's when you are in your totality that you're in your fulfillment.
If you had a chance to go back in time and speak to little Kerry, what advice would you give her?
I would say to her, hold on tight, kid. Hold on tight because you're in for the ride of your life. And it's all going to get good. It's all going to get good. Don't ever lose faith. It's all going to get good.
How do you define God or source?
Wholeness.
What is love?
Everything.
And what is the ultimate purpose of life?
To return to the wholeness that we originated from.
And where can people find out more about you and the amazing work you're doing in the world?
KerryK.com. So the joke of it all is that so many Americans, who are the vast majority of my listeners, are American. You guys, for some reason, see my name, Kerry, and then you spell it Carrie. That is not me. That is somebody else. Kerry K. And I say it like that because so many people go, oh, you spell your name with a K? Yes. So please remember Kerry, kerryk.com. Find me on my website. There's loads to look at there.
And do you have any parting messages for the audience?
Just like I would have said to little Kerry, hold on tight because it's going to get good. I tell you the same thing. Hold on tight because it's going to get good. You have no idea how powerful you are. You have no idea what's in store for you in this world, in this life, not in the next one, in this one. But you have to make room for miracles.
Kerry, it has been a pleasure speaking to you today. Thank you so much for sharing your story and all your amazing wisdom today. So I appreciate you and everything you're doing to awaken this planet. So thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thanks for watching. Click on one of the videos below to continue your journey, and don't forget to subscribe.